How's everybody doing tonight? Glad to have you join me here on our Wednesday night Bible study. And we'll be doing some prayer later. We have a couple prayer needs just to bring to everybody's attention here. But we're going to be continuing our series in Christ in every book of the Bible. Amos, Obadiah, and Jonah, three of the minor prophets today. Jonah, probably most everybody's heard of Jonah. Knows at least part of the story, right? Amos and Obadiah, not quite as famous, but if you read your Bible through the years, you at least are familiar with those names. We're going to start with Amos first and give you just a little overview, background of who Amos was. There was different times where there was great spiritual decline in the nation of Israel, as well as when the kingdom divided. There was the southern kingdom of Judah. Same thing, great times of spiritual decline. There was a time where God chose Elijah. He was just an obscure prophet, obscure man, not from a home of importance. He was on the mountains of Gilead, and God used him to turn the nation from its idolatry. Well, 150 years later, Amos comes around. Jeroboam II was on the throne. And while at this time Israel was prosperous, there was still great wickedness, and they were soon, you know, going to have an issue, and they wouldn't be so prosperous. So God put his hand on another man from the outdoors, like Elijah. He put it on Amos. Amos was a herdsman from Tekoa, just a small little village, 5 miles south by our standard of measurement, south of Bethlehem, and he lived in Judah, the southern kingdom, but most of it, his ministry was in the northern kingdom. He said this about himself: I'm not a prophet nor a son of a prophet, but I am a herdsman and a gatherer of sycamore fruit. He was a farmer, and he watched after the sheep and gathered fruit. He said, the Lord took me as I followed the flock, and the Lord said to me, go prophesy to my people, Israel. Amos' message is double message, double faceted. First, he talks about the sins of Israel and denounces them for it. But secondly, then he looks beyond that, beyond the sin, beyond the judgment that's going to come from their sin, to triumph, to overcoming, to forgiveness. And God's not going to let Israel's sin thwart or sidetrack his ultimate purpose for the nation of Israel. So we're going to look, though, where Jesus can be seen and what we can pull out of the book of Amos about our Savior, about Jesus, because the whole Bible has something to say. If you look and have spiritual eyes, has something to say about Jesus. Amos, the first part about Amos that I want to talk about that refers to the time of Christ or about Christ is he prophesies there will be a time when a great number of Gentiles would be called by his name, he says. You think about what people who are Christians are named. They're called by the name of Christ, right? We are taking his name. And James, in the book of Acts, not in the book of James, but the same man, he's speaking, and he actually quotes Amos and this prophecy. In Acts 15, verses 16 through 18, it says, after this time, I will return and rebuild David's fallen tent. Its ruins I will rebuild, and I will restore it, that the rest of mankind may seek the Lord. Even all the Gentiles who bear my name, says the Lord, who does these things, things known from a long ago. So he talks about the return and the rebuilding of David's fallen tent. That is Jesus coming and ascending as Messiah, as the King of all. As he does this, he says he's going to then have all of the nations, all the Gentiles, seek him and be called by his name. Just a little background on what happened here with James and why he talked about this. James and Paul and Peter and all the leaders of the early church, they met together in Jerusalem to decide what's going to be done. All these Gentiles were coming, and they were claiming Christ as their Lord and Savior, but they weren't following Jewish customs and Jewish ceremonies. They weren't necessarily being circumcised. They ate food, you know, they ate pork and they ate shrimp or whatever else, you know, and they didn't observe all the feasts and stuff that the Jews did. But the part of the church was saying, well, no, if they're going to be a follower of Christ, they need to do all those things. And Paul and Peter were saying, no, that is not the case. James was considered the leader of the Jewish Christians. He was considered the head of the Church of Jerusalem. You know, if we had a title, maybe it would be Bishop of Jerusalem. Yet he saw this prophecy of Amos foretelling that many Gentiles would also be called by the name of God, the God of the Jews. It was a huge moment for the early church when James stood up. A lot of people who were thinking, now everybody needs to follow these old traditions, thought James was going to be their go-to guy. He was going to be the one who would stand up for what they were saying. But he's saying, no, Amos prophesied that Gentiles would come and be called by his name and worship him. I didn't say they had to become Jewish or they had to follow our customs. They just said they all the nations, there would be somebody. So this was a huge moment for the early church. It set the early church on a trajectory of being for all people everywhere, not just for God's chosen people, the Jews, who the Messiah was going to come for, but then that Messiah would be for all of us. So yes, Amos is letting you know God's going to bring you back. He's going to restore you. It's a little bit of a future prophecy as well. In the millennial reign, you know, David's throne will be established in Jerusalem forever. And yes, the Jews and Israel will all worship and serve him there, but Gentiles from every nation will come and serve him there as well. Amos, this being his book, right? He's telling that all the Gentile nations around them, the beginning of the book, he actually addresses all of them around Israel. And he lets them know they're sinners too, not just Israel, not just Judah. And they're going to be judged as well, but that they too would have a chance at redemption and salvation. It's not just the Israelites that were sinners. You know, all these other ones, he talks about the Philistines, the Edomites, the Moabites, and the Ammonites, and the Assyrians, and you said, you know, you're all sinners as well, and you're going to get judged, but God's going to offer you too redemption through the Messiah. Let's go look at a second aspect of Amos. And how he teaches us and shows us something about Christ. He's actually a picture of Christ himself, particularly his name, but part of his ministry is a picture of Christ. His name means the burden bearer, and it's what in Hebrew literally means the bearer of a burden. And when you go back to key verses, what is so significant about him was that he was not a typical prophet. I mentioned earlier that he didn't grow up as a prophet's kid. He didn't attend some prophet school, and they did have those, believe it or not. He simply was a shepherd and a farmer called from this small village, you know, south of Jerusalem. And the Lord called him to go to this northern kingdom. The question is, why would he do that? Why would he leave his day job in the land that he grew up in, that he knew, the southern kingdom? And follow God's calling to preach in the northern kingdom. The obvious answer is his deep burden for God's people. They were about to be judged because of their sins, and he had a burden in his heart for them. He didn't want them to at least not be warned. You know, he didn't want them even to be judged. He wanted them to repent and to turn around. And Jesus, too. Jesus, he left heaven, he came down to earth. He had a great burden for us, and that's why he did it. We were lost in sin. We were facing judgment, eternal judgment. And he came down from the perfect place, and he made a way for our salvation through his death. Amos, yes, the burden compelled him. And in this way, he was a picture of who Jesus would be, and that Jesus' love would motivate him and what it would motivate him to do for us. 1 Peter 2, 24 through 25 says, He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. So he took that burden of our sin and he bore that for us, and the great burden bearer, as Amos was called. It goes on to say, for in that same scripture, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 25 says, "For you were straying like sheep, but now return to the shepherd and overseer of your souls," just like Amos was a shepherd. The great burden bearer is our Lord Jesus. He bears our burdens for us. He has a burden for us, but then he bears our burdens for us as well. He says, "Come to me, all you who are heavy laden, all you who have a big burden, for my burden is light." Okay? You say, you follow me, yes, you're going to have a burden, but it's not going to be the one of sin and shame and despair, but it's going to be a burden for others to know the good news and to know forgiveness and know salvation through me. It's much lighter burden than carrying around a hopelessness and a despair and a despondency. And then he also says, "Cast all your cares on him, for he cares for you." That's again Peter who wrote that. We don't have to carry on the burden of our cares, for our burden bearer, he takes those from us as well, because he cares for us. We can cast all of our cares on him and let him carry them. Well, that's Amos. I'm gonna touch on Obadiah now. Obadiah is the shortest book in the Old Testament. It's pretty close to the shortest book in the whole Bible. I know Philemon and Jude are also short, one chapter. Obadiah is one chapter. But Jesus claimed, he said in Luke 24, 27 and in John 5, 46, that all of the Old Testament pointed to him. And since the book of Obadiah is part of the Old Testament, let's take a look and see how it points to Jesus. Obadiah lived, and the book was written 500 or so years before Jesus. Obadiah, his name means servant of the Lord. And we could talk maybe about that a little bit, but I'm not going to. About how his name points to Christ as well, right? But the book of Obadiah can be summed up as a prophecy against Israel's neighbor, Judah and Israel's neighbor, Edom. Their neighbor to the east. Edom would be in what part of is modern day Jordan today, for anybody that's a geography buff and would know where those are at. Edom was founded, and it's another name for actually Esau. Esau was the brother of Jacob, whose name would be changed to Israel. So it's Jacob and Esau right there next to each other, and they fought and contended for years and years and years with each other, just like Israel and Ishmael's descendants have done as well. It was once again the descendants that lived in this land, and though they were relatives of God's people, the two were bitter enemies. The Bible talks about the feuding that started in the mother's womb. Esau sold his birthright to Jacob. Jacob stole Isaac's blessing from Esau. Edom refused to let the Israelites go through their land when Moses and Joshua were leading them back into the promised land. And there were times when the Babylonians had come and had conquered Judah that the Edomites laughed, and the people that fled Judah to go and the people that fled Israel to run into Edom for refuge, they were slain. And even before that, throughout the years, the Edomites would make raids on the people. They lived more in the mountains. They lived in the area which, if you've ever heard of Petra, in that area of the Middle East where this great fortress is, that was their area, that land they owned. So, again, they cheered when they were attacked, and they cheered when they would lose in battle. And for this, Obadiah, he spoke words of doom towards them. He prophesied that they would certainly be punished. He's kind of said, God's gonna discipline his people, but you shouldn't cheer when God's people are getting, when his children are getting disciplined. So what does the book of Obadiah mean for us? It's a foreshadow of Christ in the church. All those who hurt or take advantage of God's people, God sees that. And, unless someone who does that makes it right and cries out for repentance, they will receive a judgment for that, even if they seem invincible. Those faithful to God have hope for a new future through Jesus, and nothing can break God's promises to protect his people, his children, you and I. And even when it seems like people that are persecuting his people are getting away with it, they're living in the lap of luxury, everything's going great for them. Their end is spelled out if they continue to persecute God's people. You think through the years, think of Nero. how he went after Christians, Hitler, Adolf. He went after the Jews and many Christians as well who stood up against him. Really through the ages, Stalin and Mao and Pol Pot, Idi Amin, they've all gone after Christians. And it seems like, wow, they're prospering, they're doing well, but their end is always the same. So it's been a tragic and early, not sometimes suicide, sometimes execution. But so that's what God's trying to say through Obadiah. Jesus watches out for his children. And it gives us a glimpse of what it means to be God's children, to be his bride. In the same way God calls his bride, a husband looks out for his bride. He doesn't let people treat her badly. The last verse sums up Obadiah best. And the kingdom will be the Lord's. It's a promise that God's kingdom will always endure, no matter what Satan tries to come against it, no matter what we do and how we mess it up and sin, God's kingdom is still going to endure. Well, let's move on to Jonah. And Jonah, for me, there's one that jumps right out because Jesus talks about it, and that's the 3 days in the belly of the whale, or that's actually a whale, the belly of the beast, the belly of the fish. It was a misnomer that it says whale there, it actually says fish. And Jesus himself cued us into this shadow of his ministry. Jonah serves as one of the clearest types and shadows of Christ. When Jesus was asked for a sign, and the Pharisees said, and the people that were following, show us a sign, we want to see a miracle, we've come to see a show, Jesus. He staked his death, his burial, and resurrection on this prophet Jonah. Said, you want a sign? I'm going to give you a sign. Just like Jonah was in the belly of the whale or the fish for 3 days and 3 nights, the Son of Man will be in the earth for 3 days and 3 nights. So I want you to appreciate the greatness of God's word, the true beauty of what you're reading. The book of Jonah was written almost 800 years before Christ died and before Christ was buried for 3 days and 3 nights. 8 centuries before Jesus was born. It's going back to 1200 AD for us. You think about this is before Columbus. This is, at the time of, the Middle Ages, the Holy Roman Empire, the Dark Ages, as it's sometimes called. That's how far back it was between Jesus and Jonah. But God had this account with Jonah take place as a sign of what would later take place with his son. We got to remember God sees things differently and time differently. And 800 years is not a long time for him, but he established this pattern 800 years before Jesus. When Jonah 2 begins, Jonah himself uses burial language when you read this chapter. Burial language is so strong. It sounds like Jonah's actually dead. He's not in the, living in the belly of the sea monster here, but it's the strong language that helps establish the typology between Jonah's burial and Jesus. Jonah 2:2 says, I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried. Sheol is another word for the place of the dead. It was also just the grave, okay? And you heard my voice. We would think Jonah to say, out of the belly of the fish I cried. But he says it was Sheol. It doesn't even sound like he was in a fish. It sounds like he was in the place of the dead, even Hades or hell, right? That's another Greek name for Sheol is Hades. Look at Jonah 2:6a. It says, I went down to the moorings of the mountains, the earth with its bars closed behind me forever. You would kind of think Jonah would say the water had wrapped around me, that I went down to the depths of the sea. But he talks about the moorings of the mountains. It talks about it as if it's the earth. This isn't the language of the burial in the ocean. It's the burial, the language of the burial on the earth. And then in verse 6, it says, yet you have brought me up from the pit. You brought my life up from the pit, not up from the sea. but up from the pit, O Lord my God. Such language that has caused some biblical scholars to wonder if Jonah was actually dead in that whale or that fish's stomach, if he wasn't alive, you know, and maybe he was. How it'd have to be a miracle for him to be alive. God would have to preserve him because nobody would live very long at all, and living in the side of a belly of a fish, you know, you'd suffocate, right? So God would have to preserve him, but some scholars even said he was actually dead, and God rose from the dead and had the fish spit him out. So even though the fish, he was appointed to swallow Jonah, so I'm going to go into a little bit different aspect of this too. We talked about the 3 days and three nights, but I want you to think about the fish. And the Bible talks about how he was appointed to swallow Jonah. Some of the less accurate versions, you know, to make things sound more understanding, they don't use the word appointed. They'll say things like provided, God provided a fish to swallow him, or God sent a fish to swallow him. But in the original language, it was the fish was appointed for this task, almost as if he was predestined for the task. He was created. There's almost the idea of just created for this purpose, with a special purpose in mind. It was almost as if, you know, some of you, well, what kind of fish could swallow a person? And there have been some that have, but God could have just created a fish just for this purpose. It had no other species like it. We don't know, but this was its destiny, right? It was all part of the plan in the first place, and God was doing a great work here, not just in Jonah and not just in the people of Nineveh, but he was letting us know 800 years later that Jesus, being his dying and being buried for 3 days and three nights, and then his resurrection, it also was not an accident. Okay? He was appointed for this task. He was sent. The whole plan was designated from before time began. And so that's kind of another little aspect of beyond the 3 days and three nights, Jonah had a fish appointed, and Jesus had a day appointed, a cross appointed, a trial appointed for him. The last little part I want to talk with you about tonight, it goes back to Jonah. And I want to talk about Jesus and Jonah in the storm. God said go, and Jonah said no, right? And Jonah's no leads him to get on board a ship headed for Tarshish, Spain, or other parts of Western Europe. There's, you know, different scholars that say, what does Tarshish mean? It probably just means far away, uttermost ends of the earth. Jonah, he was on a boat full of pagan men, and these men are about to see that you never flee from the Creator's presence. Okay, they're all going to learn this lesson. We hear this from the historic account of the event, that God threw a great wind upon the sea, hurled a great wind, it says, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so the ship threatened to break up. It's a very similar scene to Jesus in the boat with his disciples, recorded in the Gospels. The mariners on Jonah's boat are panic-stricken by the storm. And Jonah, what's he doing? He's sleeping. The disciples, the fishermen on the boat, they're panic-stricken by the storm, and Jesus is sleeping. The ones most familiar with the sea are panic-stricken, and the ones sent by God to preach are asleep in their respective boats. It also is eerily similar to Paul and his shipwreck. He was the only one not panicked, right? But when you look to Jonah and Jesus, both are woken up by the frantic pleas of the other men on the boat. Jonah, he hears this. What do you mean, you sleeper? Arise, call out to your God. Perhaps the God will give you a thought to us, and we may not perish. And Jesus heard something like this. Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? In both cases, you know, the people kind of said, get up and do something. Do what you can. In both cases, the men believe, these men, the sailors, they believe their physical life is in danger. It's about to be overpowered by the Creator's storm on the sea. Well, Jesus speaks a word to end the storm. Jonah cannot end the storm with his words and does not seek the Creator God's intervention to calm the storm or to ease their panic. Remember, Jesus was asleep, having just finished a full day of teaching the word, one of the things he had been sent to do. Jonah was asleep, having just fled God's call to preach and teach the word. One sleeps having fulfilled God's will. One sleeps having fled God's will. So there's two very different types of sleep. And it was two different, very different ways to end the storm. One was God's power, just ended it. And one was God's judgment that ended it. You know, God was in it all, and he used it all for his glory, and he watched out for Jonah and Jesus and the disciples. But it's just a curious similarity, a little eerie, how that happened with Jonah and Jesus. It's a little shadow, a little picture of things to come. It's interesting, the disciples said that even the winds and waves have to listen, have to obey him. Who is this man? Well, we're going to close tonight with some prayer. I want to let you know next week we will not be having a Wednesday night Bible study. I will be gone. Going to my wife's brother died, passed away on Tuesday morning, early Tuesday morning. And so the funeral is in Illinois this weekend. And then we're taking a little vacation time after that. So we won't be doing the Wednesday night Bible study next week, this Sunday at church. Yvonne Pulliam, a pastor, Yvonne Pulliam, will be preaching. And so we're looking forward to what God has put on her heart to say. We will not be doing a live stream for this Sunday service, just so you're aware of that. We will start the live stream up back again on February 27th. So we appreciate your prayers. Appreciate your prayers for my wife. God is good and ministering to her and the rest of the family. And her brother Steve did know the Lord and is with him now. We know that. A couple of other just things to be thinking of or praying about. I've heard from Troy and Joyce Seeger's daughter. They're both having continued struggling health issues. Both have been in the hospital. Troy just got airlifted there today. He had a heart attack. So just be praying for Troy and Joyce. Joyce has some other health issues having to do with some of her diabetes and infections and stuff like that. So just be praying for both of them. Our neighbor to the church, Anita, too, she had a fall this week and fell down and hurt herself. She's okay. She's home, but she just asked us to pray for her as well. And I know that there's others out there who are asking for prayer, some that are, you know, dealing with or have friends or family that are either they themselves or friends or family are dealing with COVID or dealing with cancer, have lost loved ones. So, we just want to lift all of our church family and you up in prayer today. Maybe you have a request and you just mention it to the Lord right now as we're going to close in prayer. Pray that God would touch you as well. Lord Jesus, I thank you tonight for everyone that's tuned in and listened, or those who are listening later. I pray that you would move and touch them. Lord, you know the needs and the hurts and the health issues and the struggles they might be having, financial issues, Lord. I pray that you would touch and they would surrender, Lord. Your burden is light, and they would cast those things upon you and or trust in you. And hold on lightly to the things of this world and hold on tightly to your hand as we walk through this world. Lord, I thank you as we read all of your word. You're so evident. You're there. Your plan is there. And as we are assured of that, we know that you're in our lives today. And your plan is working in our lives today. As surely as it was there during the time of these prophets, it is here now during our time. Ask your blessing now over your people. In your name, amen. God bless you. Thank you so much. We've just appreciated everybody at the church. I know we haven't got the word out to everybody what's going on, but everybody that has heard about my wife's brother has been just so kind, and we love you all. And I know some of you even that don't go to church here at Central, but we've known from other places, sometimes tune in and watch these as well, and other friends have reached out with words of encouragement. We appreciate you all. And we look forward to being back with you after we're done with this little trip. And somebody asked if the dinner's still going to go on Sunday after church. Yes, the dinner's still happening. So will be a great time as the Family Life Center Committee is putting that together. So we're gonna miss it. So we'll have to wait till next year for the chili beans and the other good stuff. But I hope you all enjoy it. So God bless and have a great time.